Harper government tried to ignore it, but really, without proper consultation, without recognition of resource rights, nothing is going to move in this country. Pipelines will not be built. You know, things are going to slow right down. The Ring of Fire, Ontario, is stalled. Gateway Pipeline to British Columbia is either not going to go or stalled, and so on and so forth. And this is all because these resources have been developed unilaterally, without any input from us, without any revenue coming to us. There's nothing in it for us. Why should we allow them to do it? And so that's sort of the attitude that's across the country. And it may well be that when we get resource revenue, then they'll, you know, we'll be moving ahead on some of these projects, but they'll all have to be looked at very carefully, make sure they're environmentally sound. And in his book, Resource Rulers, Bill Gallagher writes, Canada may well have evolved as a country built on resource exports, but our resources future sees natives in the driver's seat as resource rulers, and that's because native strategists have both hands on the secret levers of power, one in the law court and one in the court of public opinion. Thus, for industry, the old order is over, and major challenges lie ahead in earning the social license to operate. End of quote. So you can see that we've made an enormous stride from where we were when we had 11,000 people in this province, and we were losing land left and right for settlers. We've come full circle. We now have all the tools to be major players in resource development in this country. So, following the daily news is like listening to a play about a hockey game with no reference to the score, the time on the clock, and the teams standing in the league. It's merely one event after another, and there's no reference points. I'd just like to close with a story that I did a few years ago. I did a documentary for the National Film Board. And I met with this woman. She was a recovering drug addict and a sex trade worker. And I wanted to tell her story because it was one of where she'd gone through rehabilitation, gone through suffering, and actually had really turned her life around and was helping other people. But when I got into that story, I spoke to her mother. And her mother had a very rough life as an alcoholic and a sex trade worker. And then I went back, she told me about her father. And her father was sexually abused at boarding school. He enlisted in the army and went overseas during the Second World War. Came back traumatized and was never the same again. And he would abuse his daughter, or this lady. And she ran away from home. Her sons and daughters were taken away from her by social services. And those kids grew up, they had problems, and their kids were taken away by social services. And now the family, the mother, who unfortunately died last summer, had spent, at least a decade clean and sober and working as a counselor to other people. And the daughter had done the same thing. And one by one, they were bringing the kids back. And the next generation was finding life a lot easier. They were living clean and sober. There was all the dysfunction was, I shouldn't say all, there was always problems, but most of the dysfunction was gone, and they were starting to settle back into a regular life, and they're moving forward. So after the story itself, when I started with one generation, really went to five generations. It went to the woman and her grandfather, and the woman and her grandchildren. So that's, when you look at our people and where we've been and what we've done and where we've gone through, you just can't take us as one individual. You have to look back, you have to see where we've come from, you have to see where we're going, and you see what we've done to better ourselves, because there's an awful lot there. And generations do not stand alone. We're all a product of a history, we all contribute in some way to the future. And while the newsrooms have the duty to report the events of the day, opinion pieces and background articles must remind us of our shared history and tell that story with all its warts and blemishes. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Doug. And now we have just a chance to ask Doug questions. So we have two microphones, as you see. Let's take turns. So as soon as you have a question, you ask one mic. And then if there's other people, just, you know, form a sort of a queue and, you know, ask questions. So that's how it always works. And also, I would suggest to have questions. So try to avoid the long statements before that. Sometimes it does happen.
Hi. Just as a quick note, your introduction was as the first Indigenous person giving the Minifee lecture, but I remember somebody else, Wab Canute, from a few years ago, so you have the privilege of being the second. Your name's been familiar to me for years. What do you think is the best input you've got to make to Saskatchewan journalism, your work as a Minifee broadcaster, or do you still hold the opinion that the written word has more power?
That's asking me which one of my children I prefer. Really, both have their, both are, like I say, documentary filmmaking is wonderful. You get beautiful pictures and you can really tell a good story. But on the other hand, with a column, you're swinging there without a safety net. You've got to tell it as it is. You've got to use your own words. You can't, you know, it's on the record. So I really hesitate to say yes or no. By the way, these guys were saying I'm the first guy from Saskatchewan. That's,
okay. Okay.
Hi,
Sean.
I'm Sean Perpick.
I planted him. Yeah.
I was very excited about your optimistic view of the bright future, essentially, for First Nations in Saskatchewan. You're committed to a vision of victory in the long term, I guess, as people wait. But I'm just wondering, in the sort of the short to medium term, there seem to be a lot of social tensions between the Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal communities. We've got stuff that's in the news right now. People talk about the Bushy case and all the rest of it. How does that jibe, you know, with the tensions that we're facing now, how does that jibe with your grand vision of the future?
Yeah, well, I am optimistic, I have to be. But there's a lot of problems as we go along. As I mentioned earlier, half our population is under the age of 20. Now, I don't know about you, but young people get in trouble by the age of 15 and 25. So we've got a huge population of people in that area, both men and women, young men and young women. And so that's one area. You have the urbanization, mass urbanization. And so you've got kids now growing up outside of their elders and sphere of influence on the reserve. So that creates problems. So there are a number of problems that we're facing, but we've also got the people with the education and the moxie that are working to work on those problems. So it's, you know, let me remind you of a story of a group of people who were taken off the land, forced into the cities, fell into drunkenness and dysfunction. And I'm not talking about our people. I'm talking about Britain during the Industrial Revolution. You know, it's happened all over the world. It's not unique to us. It happens to everybody, not everybody. It happens as societies evolve and move on. So, you know, there is this, I don't want to lighten it up and say it's just collateral damage, because it isn't. It's very serious. But, we do have to, you know, definitely have to address these issues.
Do you think that there's a risk, if there isn't enlightened leadership on all sides, that we could, you know, slip into real problems?
Yeah, well, you know, you've been with the news media.
since I was a little boy. Yeah. Almost as long as you.
Yeah, you're retarded. No, but like I said, we have a big population now, and a very varied population. And yes, there are tensions. There's no doubt about it. There's growing race relations in this province. There is negative race relations in this province. No doubt about it. But on the other hand, there are enlightened people. There are a lot of people working within government, within organizations, within institutions that are bringing people together on both sides. Both sides. So, you know, one day it looks really bad because you have something happening with the Colton situation. And then another day you have graduation where there's 100 university students graduating with First Nations degrees. So it's, you know, one gets reported, one doesn't.
Just one last thing. I found it very interesting when you were talking about being in the Cypress Hills and having this maybe this historical memory of you know what it was like in the past. And I find that really interesting. I'm working with a young African-Canadian documentary maker, and he's looking at a growing body of science that says trauma, historical trauma, actually has a genetic effect. Those genes can be expressed in the structure of our brains. So he's looking at the black experience in Canada. But there's a growing feeling in the scientific community that what certain populations have gone through actually affect their brains. And so history can actually transform their genetic structure. So you might be onto something.
Yeah, that's
the research
in
that.
Tonsei, aloha shite, welcome to Treaty 4, Doug. I know you came all the way from Treaty 6. My question is with regards to your comment that you made, most youth get into trouble between the ages of 15 and 25, and right now we have a really high population of First Nations gangs and incarceration rates. What role, if any, does a journalist have in order to be able to help assist those youth with taking a different path? Rather than the hard news mentality of this violence happened, this kid died, this adult's going to prison, that's all that comes out in the news right away. It's just hard facts. So what role, specifically as the younger journalists come up, how can they attack that to help them make a positive out of the negative?
Yeah, that's a very good point. I'm glad you raised it. In Saskatoon, there's a group called Straight Up. And they're a group that is assisting ex-gang members to reintegrate into society. And they've received quite a bit of ink, not as much as I'd like. And I'd like, you know, maybe a little more reporting. But nevertheless, that's a good news type of story. And that's what we need to show our youth, these things, too, that there's other options out there besides, you know, what they're doing. And unfortunately, I don't think very many of them read the newspapers. So we have to get out there in other ways. If they don't do it one way, find another way. Social media, television, whatever. I think we have to adjust our ways to the new generation out there, the new technologies, and get the same message out, but just use different vehicles to get it out there.
All right. Having been a journalist and a consumer of the media so long, what would you like to see change with regards to how the Saskatchewan and the Canadian media covers Indigenous issues? Thanks.
Actually, there's lots of ways that we've done. I look at how shows like Indigenous Circle, and we're getting more reporters in newsrooms. I think it's not a question of, well, it is a bit of how to cover things, but it's also changing the color of the newsroom. Newsrooms are, if you walk into the Star Phoenix, with a few exceptions, it's mainly white faces looking back at you. You go into the Leader Post, I think it's probably the same way. You've got to get a mixed bag of people. And I'm not just talking about Indian people, I'm talking about Chinese people, black people, whoever, because Canada is made up of a whole rainbow of people, there's no doubt about it. And so we've got to reflect that in newsrooms. And once you start to reflect that, then you'll start to see news reporting take a different twist. I'm just thinking, there was I don't know, quite a few years ago that Air India jet went down, and all these people were killed. None of the newsrooms had Indian reporters. They couldn't get out there to talk to the families. They didn't know how to do it. And the RCR, the police forces, didn't have, I'm talking about East Indian people here, didn't have any of them on their force to go to the families and tell them what happened. So if you don't have those kind of people within your institutions, you're not going to be getting you're not going to be doing your best job. So that's what I think. You have to get a wide range of experience and raises in different newsrooms, so these people will be able to know the background of the story before they go into it. They won't walk in blind and get culture shock. They'll know what's going on. So I think that's just one way to deal with it.
Hi, Sheila Stevenson from Pasqua First Nation. I just wanted to say how excited I am to be here. And whenever a new issue would come out in Indian country, I would look in the newspaper, and then I would look online to find your column. And I've heard your documentaries on CBC Ideas. One of my all-time favorites is one on horses, and I just wanted to share that with you because I thought that was so meaningful on our reserve and to the young people. I'm a teacher and a writer, and I'm very interested in the history, and I'd like to learn more about that in the context of our history as people on Pasqua, and then in a larger picture for the province and the country and the world. So I want to thank you for coming out tonight and really made my evening.
Well, thank you.
Me quetch.
I shot the movie Big Bear on Pasqua. It's a lot of fun, a lot of good people, a lot of great scenery, and it wasn't a bad job either.
Daniel Porter, Summer Regina Métis. Just thinking in terms of your journalism and stuff like this, just with the consolidation that's going on in the mainstream media, and that's a frightening enough concept. But you mentioned social media, which is completely dependent on the electronic media, which is also experiencing centralization or consolidation in the hands of very, very exclusive and rich few, right? What do you see in the future, like in terms of our ability to when the media and media organs are all controlled by by that smaller and smaller minority of people? Just a question. I couldn't go any further.
Yeah, at one time the newspapers were broadly owned, and now they're owned by just a few companies, like Post Media and others. And they don't just own a newspaper, they own a whole media empire. I think social media, though, is one area where the Wild West still kind of exists for a little bit anyway. I was down in Standing Rock, North Dakota, and I've been following it ever since I got back. And you can follow it on social media. You have to be careful what you read. You have to be critical. This is where critical thinking comes in. Just don't believe everything you see. But there's pictures and there's stories and there's things that are happening. And if you put it all together, you will get a picture of what's taking place. Muskrat Falls, for example, is in the news yesterday and today up in Labrador. But that's been on social media for weeks now. So I've been following that story as well. So when our people take over a place, or take a demonstration or something takes place, you'll find social media gets out right away with the story. When I was in Standing Rock, there was a hill inside the camp, and they call it Facebook Hill. Everybody, goes on top and sits there on the floor, getting out the pictures and telling the world what's happening. Because Standing Rock has been really ignored. I think PBS did one or two stories. SCN's been there. I think even Fox News went once, just to be skeptical. The Bismarck Tribune is to the right of Fox News. And so, there's very poor coverage coming out of there. The honest coverage, let's put it that way, is coming out on social media. So yeah, I think that's for the time being, that's our savior. We will be able to find out what's going on through that. Because it's not that media is inaccurate, in newspapers and stuff. They report their facts, and they also select which stories they will report. If they don't want to report a story, they won't report it. And something major can happen, and you never hear about it. Someone pointed out, it was on CBC Radio, I think, today on the way down. Someone was talking about the ISIS attack in France and the people that were killed. And a day or a week earlier, 40 people had been killed in Lebanon by a car bomb, and it wasn't even reported in mainstream news. Yeah. So the news media will pick and choose what they want, and some important stories will be left behind, and you don't get a complete picture. So you have to practice critical thinking, and you have to research these stories. I'm talking to
your
professor.
Hi, Doug. I'm going to make it over there. Speaking of critical thinking, I wanted to ask you, what do you think of the Saskatchewan media's coverage of Colton Bush's death and the subsequent journalists?
I am not very impressed. It took the Globe and Mail to come out and do the story. And the news media picked it up off the Globe and Mail and re-reported it. I wasn't very happy about that. The RCMP sent out an erroneous press release with full of all kinds of holes and problems, problematic stuff. So yeah, that story has not received the kind of reporting it deserves. There's still more to be told. Every time you talk to the police, they won't talk about anything because it's before the courts. So that's getting a little old. The problem is when you don't report something properly and you sort of throw a scare across the land, something happens like out in Rosetown where some unidentified people wearing masks jumped out of a car. We don't even know what race they were. All the farmers, Indians, they blame them and then they armed themselves. We're lucky there isn't more people get shot like this. If the farmers are going to arm themselves like that, they're going to get trigger happy. We got real problems. We're going to be like a deep south here in a little while.
I'm Bob Brownridge. I'm a former fine arts graduate. I just wanted to thank you for writing an article on Alan Sapp. I had a chance to meet him up in North Battleford, and I think he's been quite an inspiration to artists and people in the fine arts area. And I just wanted to thank you for writing the article.
You talked a little bit about how the media in Saskatchewan was very racist in the beginning, and it's better now. But do you see an end to the Gormleys of the world? And also, should we shelter ourselves from that and the message boards, or should we know what they're thinking? Or, what's the future?
First of all, let me talk about Gormley. Because if you go to a newspaper today and look in the newspaper, you don't really look for the news. You've got the news. It came off of the radio, it came off of the 24-hour news channel. And so when you get to the newspaper, you got to look for background material, and you got to look for opinion pieces. And that's where guys like Gorman come in, and me for that matter too. You throw opinion out there, you get people talking, you get people mad, you stampede the herd, I don't care what you do. But if the whole idea is to make people aware of things, and I'm not going to say anything pro or con about John Bartlett, because that's his job. it's a funny vocation being a columnist. You're supposed to get people mad at you, and that's sort of your lot in life. But there's the racism that exists in Saskatchewan. It comes out on in the message boards and in the like the farmers' media there where they were after the Colton murder. It's very revealing and it's very hurtful. It scares the hell out of you because all of a sudden you realize, after writing columns for 25 years and trying to educate people, we still got these guys doing message boards, and you wonder what the heck. It is good cause for concern. There are some people, a friend of mine was Jim Hansen, he was, or Bill Hansen, pardon me. He was, worked for Canada Manpower, and he used to tell me that 40% of the people are with us. He was Métis, by the way. 40% of the people are with us, 40% can be convinced, and 20% are against us, and no matter what you say, they'll never come on side. So that's kind of how I work, and I go with the theory that if you talk to the converted and get their friends on side, you'll isolate the negativity. And that's the way I'm not going to fight with people, I'm not going to beat my head against a brick wall, but I'm just going to isolate these people as much as you possibly can.
And you see, Doug, as a fellow Treaty 6 member, and I'll vote it down to Treaty 4 again. I know it's a long trip. They say it's a long walk, short duck. Which brings me to a twofold question, because you're one of my journalism heroes that I've watched my entire life. Thank you very much, first of all, for all of your hard work. You've brought Native Canada into the spotlight in so many different ways. I can't tell you how much you appreciated it. My question, I work with the with a group called All Nations Hope, and we do a resolution health support program, and we've highlighted and finished off the TRC work for the last 4 years. Now, in my mind, you've watched the creation of what became the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in your experience. And this question would be from a younger to an elder. It's got two parts to it. If you could pull the veil back on 150 years of this 2017 celebration coming of Canada being a country, and you could take the journalist and put him 150 years in the past, do you think a lot of the issues that we're discovering that are currently in the burner about Native people in general in Canada have changed that much in that time? And if so, how would they change? What would the points be that have adapted? The country's changed around us, we've changed as people, but perhaps the issues that you would have seen as a young man, maybe they're still in the ruts. The other part to my question involves, if you were to take those seven generations of people since the newcomers have come, being part of the elder brother culture and watching the younger brothers show up, now that the younger brother's beginning to grow and understand what's going on Turtle Island, and the elder brother seeing his maturity as a group of people. If you were to stand yourself as a fourth generation person, with me being a seventh generation person at my age, what would be your advice for the eighth generation that has to take on our world, where older Trudeau has watched the white paper get reenacted on the other side of the white paper with his son, now in the position of celebrating the TRC?
Okay. I have to go back to your first question. 150 years ago, journalism really didn't exist as a profession. It was it was reporting and stuff, but it was very biased. It was not value-free. It certainly wasn't free of racial overtones. It was very different from what it is today. I think the very fact that we've survived, we didn't disappear, we've grown considerably. We're now part of the fabric of this nation. And because of all those things, today's journalists can't ignore us. They have to grow, study, be critical thinkers themselves, and involve us in the stories of the day. We're part of the nation. I'm not 150 years old. I wasn't a young man. But nevertheless, there's been an enormous evolution in Canada. When Canada, here's the history lesson, when Canada started, the Red Rebellion, so-called rebellion, was fought because the British Protestants in Eastern Canada didn't want a Western, Catholics in Western Canada. That's what it was mainly about, from the government's point of view. And we've gone way beyond that. Once we were as crazy as Northern Ireland, and we've left that way behind us. So there's been a lot of growing up and a lot of evolution here in this country. As far as the eighth generation, I find that's very interesting. I'll have to think about that. But that eighth generation has got more going for it than a lot of us could ever dream of. There's doors opened up. There's so many new things. There's so many pitfalls out there too. There's stuff that our ancestors never had to deal with, like drugs and gangs, stuff like this. Jails that are run like industrial warehouses. It's changed a lot. And for the people who survive, people who do well, it's going to be great. See, the way I look at it, our society is going in, I'd say, three directions. We can discuss this. One part is moving ahead, getting educated, moving into professions, doing well. Another part is falling behind. They're falling prey to drugs, unemployment, poverty, these kind of things. All these social indicators are falling on them. And then there's a third group, and this is a group I find really interesting. It's the group that have kind of turned their back on material goods, and have also turned their back on drugs and substance abuse, this type of thing, and have embraced Indian religion, Indian culture, and they're living a clean life, but they're also very much immersed in their culture and religion. And so, all of us have parts of that in us. Some of us have friends and relatives who have poverty and problems. Some of us are able to thrive, and all of us have a certain amount of spirituality. So that's it's very difficult to define the next generation, because there's going to be all three of those elements to deal with.
Very nice comment.
Revenues are going to come only when the Indians try to get control.
No, the way I look at it is it'll be the environmental side of things will play a very, very important role. When I was down in Standing Rock, I was talking to guys who were there, and they were saying that they had worked on pipelines. They had worked in the oil patch, but they feared this pipeline, well, for two reasons. First of all, they'd gone through traditional land, and they unearthed a graveyard, for heaven's sake, and some historical markers have disappeared. But it's also going to be put underneath the Missouri River at a place where the river is very wide. So there's a lot of danger there. These people weren't, I can't generalize. There's a group of people there who are 100% opposed to pipelines. There are those who want to see development, but safe development. Like the pipeline should have gone to the north of Bismarck, but because it was too close to the city and a threat to their water supply, they put it on north of Standing Rock, so it's a threat to their water supply. There's, it's just selfish. Even though the river is narrower by far up at Bismarck. So yeah, you can't shove people aside. I guess that's my point. We didn't get anything from clear-cutting the forests in northern Saskatchewan. We got very little from the different mines that have gone out there. Recently we've gotten more employment, contracts, this sort of thing. But as far as to get any kind of serious revenue, that's still yet to come. And because of the court cases that are being fought and won by our people, it's going to be a reality someday. And we will be entitled to resource revenue, but there's so many different kinds of resource revenue. There's revenue from ordinary oil wells, and there's the tar sands, which are a totally different beast, and this and that. So you have to weigh everything. Like, I don't see very many people supporting the Gateway Pipeline. It's just too dangerous. It goes through mountain passes and over, I don't know how many rivers and whatnot. It's just too dangerous. It just doesn't make sense. It only makes sense if you want to make a quick buck. So these things have to be looked at. It's hard to just say yes or no from a podium. You got to research it. You got to look at it. You got to see what you can do with it.
I just want to thank everybody for coming tonight. Let's hear it one more time for Mr. Doug Hutt. And on behalf of the School of Journalism at the University of Regina, I would like to say, Kinanaskamoten, Wopinatonka, and to the English speakers out there, thank you.
Some sort of rest and to discuss the management. So thank you for coming.